Now, string splitting. Any truck in CACC may decide to leave the string at any time and go away. I think this was one of the questions, that what happens when one of the trucks decides to leave the string and travel on its separate path. The effect of this departure on the string will depend on which truck is exiting. Like, suppose the lead truck is exiting, then automatically the next truck, the second truck in the string, will become the new lead. So in an ideal departure, the driver of the departing truck will inform all the other trucks that it is leaving by giving a signal through its turn indicator or through the instrument control panel given to the driver. Once the driver is information to depart, the other drivers are notified also. Then all of them are aware of the information. Okay, this particular truck is leaving and we will have to have a new lead in case the first truck, and if there is a middle truck leaving, then the case changes. So in that, the departing truck will leave the lane and the remaining trucks behind it will close the gap by forming a temporary lead behind. Like I said, we were having five trucks. The third truck decides to leave. So it will leave the lane on its own, and the fourth truck becomes the temporary lead and it will accelerate and join the second truck again to make a new string of four vehicles, with the first vehicle again becoming the lead. Sometimes the departing truck needs to have manual speed control before changing lanes. So there are two cases of changing lanes. One, you're driving at, suppose, constant speed in the string for 50 kilometers per hour. All five trucks are driving. I am in the middle truck. I've decided to leave the string. So I just turn my steering and leave the lane and go to the other lane. This is still happening in constant speed mode. But sometimes the driver has to take control of the speed of the truck by pressing on the accelerator and accelerating and overtaking the truck by exiting the lane. So that is another case. So I hope string splitting is clear. Before this, we just saw the steady state cruising, string splitting, and now the final, fault conditions. This is the fourth functionality. This should also answer one of the questions. Design of the CACC system will need to consider a number of potential faults, errors, or abnormal operating conditions. The first issue that we must consider is what happens when CACC system is disengaged unwantedly. Like, we have not disengaged the system, by any driver has not disengaged the system, but the system still fails. No matter if the system is disengaged, it is critical that the communication between the trucks does not break, because each and every truck is relying on those communications. What happens? The communication module is designed in such a way that it is independent of CACC system. So if CACC gets disengaged, the communication is still there. That communication is generally through direct short-range communication, DSRCC broadcast. That communication needs to be there. Otherwise, the other trucks will not be informed of this failure of the CACC. Another feature which generally trucks are using right now for CACC is a kill switch. So by using a kill switch, if there is a functionality issue, like you are operating the CACC and there is some problem, it is not functioning properly and it is not disengaging on its own. So you use the kill switch to kill the system directly and inform the other trucks using the communication method that, okay, so in case of, we have killed the system on our own because it was not behaving as per the requirements. So now every truck is on its own. Again, communication should not break. Other fault conditions is like data mismatch should not happen between the sensor data and the communication of direct short range. An important point is how the CACC system handles road hazards. Like, in front of the lead vehicle, suddenly a car comes and stops, or suddenly there is construction. There was no I2V infrastructure available. So communication, I2V communication was not there. And suddenly construction is there on the road and there is an accident already on the road. And the lead vehicle is responsible in these cases. So what happens is ki all the trucks behind the lead vehicle have very limited vision because they are following the first truck. So this places very huge amount of additional responsibility on the driver of the lead truck. If there is a stopped car, suppose, or obstruction on the road, the lead truck cannot simply change lanes immediately because this will surprise the drivers following it because they have not seen it. Only the lead truck has seen it. So this is one point which in the long term, CACC will need to incorporate in itself that the communication of these unwanted road issues happens to the following trucks as well. So for this, the CACC system will need to send instructions with respect to lane changing or road hazards to the other trucks. Also, in case of emergency braking, we need to have operational considerations, how the CACC system will inform the following vehicles that the lead vehicle has done an emergency brake. Suppose the lead vehicle suddenly presses brake. The following vehicles will not be able to realize why the lead vehicle has pressed brake, but they need to be aware of pressing the brake. So this is where collision avoidance system, which was initially discussed in adaptive cruise control, comes into picture, that it immediately detects the lead vehicle and the following vehicles as a collision. So it will stop the vehicle on its own. So that is also a functionality of CACC built in itself. And in case of soft braking also, that once a soft braking is done, and the issue is resolved, all the trucks need to re-accelerate and go to the original traveling speed. So that is also a functionality which is embedded in CACC. This is one of the last topics, benefits and advantages of CACC. Obviously, it improves safety due to faster reaction times because it's an electronic controlled system. Manual human control is definitely slower and electronics is much faster. Improved energy efficiency by reducing aerodynamic drag. Like, since all the trucks are traveling in a straight line, only the aerodynamic drag will be maximum on the truck at the lead and considerably lower on the trucks behind. So this in turn helps in reducing your fuel consumption. Another aspect is because of reduced braking and acceleration, since everything is controlled, there'll be reduced, unnecessary braking will not happen, unnecessary acceleration will not happen. Since it's a string, it will continuously travel on a highway. Because of which, if you take an average of the reduction in fuel consumption, we see almost 25% reduction in fuel cost of the entire platoon, taken as an average. Obviously, this value keeps on varying with respect to the testing scenarios and environmental conditions and etc. But it's a general value. And it helps in reducing the congestion on the roads. Now, CACC becomes a very important intermediary step, according to me. The world is today aiming for driverless cars, autonomous cars, level 5 autonomy. Now, CACC becomes a very crucial intermediate step because it gives you a long-term vision of how trucks will operate in a closely coupled platoon manner on both long haul and short haul, obviously, but closely operated autonomous group of trucks becomes a very good setting to understand individual autonomous cars, because individual cars, you need more level of control to avoid accidents in case of driverless. Whereas if you have 5 trucks, of which only one is controlling the other 4, then you have much more chances of experimenting and making sure accidents don't happen. So it becomes a very important intermediary step. Next is challenges. Obviously, we have legal and regulatory obligations because these kind of technologies don't exist and have not for the last 5 years, before last 5 years. So we do not have proper legal framework existing. Very recently, California has given some testing permissions and operating permissions on its California state road in US, but not other countries. Only for testing primarily, but that is one of the challenges which it needs to meet. Second is obviously the design limitations of the system. It's a man-made system. By default, it's going to have design limitations. Like, first of all, I mentioned loss of communication. It should not happen, but what if it happens? So these are some questions which need to be answered and solutions need to be figured out. Hazardous road and weather conditions. For example, trucks driving in African road conditions or in Arctic road conditions will have extremely different environments to handle. Like the traction or the friction in the ice roads in the north of Canada and Arctic regions is not as good as on a regular highway. So how those changes are going to be incorporated into each and every CACC collision avoidance systems. And another important thing is heterogeneous vehicle communication. For example, we have trucks of one manufacturer. right now traveling in CACC. But what if we want five different trucks of five different manufacturers from five different places in the continent to travel together? So having a platform which is common for all the trucks, whether it is of any brand, of any year manufacturing, of any model. So that is also a huge challenge which we are going to have to discuss in the future. Possible career trajectories and opportunities. This is very abstract from my point of view with respect to CACC, because CACC is just an application of technology. But an ideal case definitely is a electronics or a computer science engineer with a sound understanding of vehicle dynamics. Now, vehicle dynamics is generally a topic which mechanical engineers are more familiar with. But if you look at electronics and computer science engineers, if they gain the knowledge of vehicle dynamics, which in itself is not very difficult, but if they gain that knowledge, then those are the people who will get the best chance to work on these systems, because they have the programming and the electronics background from their education. However, a mechanical engineer has equal scope if he is able to do coding as well as electronics hardware. So it's open to all kinds of people, machine learning enthusiasts, computer scientists, robotics engineers, hardware and sensor technology engineers who want to work on communication engineers. Like, so there'll be some people who will be working on the communication technology, some on the braking. So you will need a whole plethora of engineers working on these concepts. So CACC becomes just one application for these engineers, but otherwise you have endless possibilities. This is a small video which basically brings in everything which we have discussed. Thank you, everyone.